so that in every way they will make the teaching about God our Savior attractive. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. While we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. 15. These, then, are the things you should teach. Encourage and rebuke with all authority. Do not let anyone despise you.
So basically, he instructs Timothy what older men, older women need to do, what younger women need to do, and how they should instruct younger women, what young men need to do, and show integrity and soundness of speech. We dealt with last week. Then it comes to a point that is very, I will not even use the word controversial, because it shouldn't be controversial, but because of times and seasons have changed, it becomes an issue for certain people. And that is 9, teach slaves to be subject to their masters in everything, to try to please them, not to talk back to them, and not to steal from them, but to show that they can be fully trusted. The background of slavery in the time of Paul was very harsh, just like we have studied slavery in the 20th century, and some even argue that it's still going on right now in different forms. And he's saying that teach the slaves to be subject to their masters in everything, to try to please them, not to talk back to them. Some will call this problematic text because of the challenges involved in slave trade in the day. The challenge then even is more in the word in everything. What we need to look at is the providence of God. And what we need to look at is looking at the bigger picture. Because Jesus has made it very clear to us that whatever you do to the Lord, whatever you do, do it as unto the Lord. Have a complete passion in everything you do, because he is the one that can take you from whatever problem you are in into a better situation. So, number one, Paul is not endorsing slavery. And he is not by all means saying that human beings ought to subject other human beings to bad treatment. What he's saying is those who have found themselves already in that situation must do it as unto the Lord, so that God himself can come through for them. Now, we need to understand one thing, that Paul's position is such that he cannot deliver the slaves. And if wrong teachings are given to the slaves, that teaching would then cause aggravated problems for them. So it is very important that you do what God's will is in any particular situation you find yourself in, and believe God to take you out of there. And it is under this premise Paul was giving us that particular exposition by the leading of the Holy Spirit. So he says, teach slaves to be subject to their masters. Now, if we now have to transpose this into our day-to-day workings, then we will say that those who have been employed in different fields of employment, we should then be subject to our masters. That in everything there, putting it also in our context, will mean according to your contract. So it will not be like everything. It will be according to your contract. It's very interesting you understand that. Hallelujah. So if your boss is telling you to do something outside of your contract, you can say no. If you feel that you can do and present that as a Christian, the Bible says that when somebody goes 1 mile, you have to go 2 miles with the person, that is fine. But can I tell you that sexual favors is not part of your contract? Can I tell you that providing ungodly services is not part of your contract? And if they want to release you of your contract because you're not doing things, then let it be. So, but this particular context is very, very clear that slaves and in this particular generation, not slaves, but workers need to do what must be done in order for God's name to be glorified. Why? Because our very lives is an epistle that is being read. So wherever God puts you to work, note that that place is also an answer to your prayer. Very important. It is an answer to your prayer. God says, I will feed you. But he never says, I will throw money from heaven every morning for your breakfast and every afternoon for your dinner. God says, I will pay your school fees. He never said that I'm going to throw monies from the heavens to the headmaster or the provost of the university and so on and so forth. God never said that. He said, I will take care of you. He didn't say that I will every morning send Santa Claus from the North Pole with a whole bunch of bags of rice and so on and so forth for you to be able to enjoy. What he would do is that he would give you employment. Paul writes very powerfully, I think, in Ephesians, and he said, let him that stole steal no more. Let him that stole steal no more. Then he goes on to say, let him work with his hands. Because God is saying that I'm going to bless you by blessing the work of your hands. So it's important that everybody works. I told you on Sunday that one of the things that God can't stand is laziness. And I told you that there are people in the body that have been positioned in the realms of laziness. And they feel that everybody owes them and they owe nobody anything. And that is really wrong. So he's teaching work ethic here. I told you again a few weeks ago that the church started as a welfare state. And the Bible says that people will sell their properties and they'll bring. But let's be real. Once you start selling properties, where do you end? When everybody has sold their property, there'll be no properties to sell anymore. So people were selling their properties and they were chopping it, selling, they were chopping it. And it got to a time there were no properties to be sold. And the lazy ones who were sitting there, brother, sister, Paul then had to come and address the situation. He said now that everybody, oh yeah, get up, go and find a job to do. And then bring the money to help other people who are disadvantaged. He then spells out a very clear policy that every member must work. Every member must work. I repeat, every member must work. And if your work is not coming, then do something about it, because that is the miracle God gives you. And that is what the Bible talks about, seed and bread in Corinthians. And it says that he who gives you bread also gives you seed, so that you work for your bread and he gives you seed so you can plant the seed for other bread to come and you have seed. So teach slaves to be subject to their masters in everything, to try to please them. And so we have to understand what we do in our workplace. I know this may raise a few questions, and if you have any, I will deal with it after I finish teaching. Not to talk back to them and not to steal from them, but to show that they can be fully trusted. Now you can imagine the way the slaves were treated. So sometimes any opportunity they get to steal, they steal. Any opportunity they get to damage things, they damage, because slavery in those days and recent times has been very, very terrible thing. But he was advising them that the Christian attitude, the godly attitude, must always be seen. And this is what we have been called to do. It says, so that in every way they will make the teaching about God our Savior attractive. Amen. 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 That's one area that I want to spend some time on. Bible says that our life in the workplace must be very attractive so that those who don't know Christ will come to know Christ. It's important then that you and I not only pray, but put structures in place to make sure that God is glorified. Now, especially in this end time, where the Bible has prophesied that people will not endure sound doctrine, people will not behave the way they ought to, and the Bible says that they will bring the word of God into disrepute. The interesting thing I discovered, and I think I taught this a few weeks ago, the interesting thing I discovered is that it is not the true believers who are now behaving that way, because there is fear of God in anybody that is truly born again. There are people holding microphones. There are people leading choirs. There are people leading home cell groups. There are people leading different aspects who have crept in. They have the same feel of what the Bible says, but they deny the power thereof. And in my opinion, these are the people who are giving Christianity a bad name. Now, don't misunderstand me. Nobody is perfect. Somebody can be judged on some imperfections, and that can bring God's name into disrepute. And we all pray that we don't get there. But the fact that it is now on the huge increase tells us that there are a bunch of people who have crept in, according to Jude, unawares, and are giving the Christian lifestyle a bad name. Do we keep quiet? No. We then who believe that we're genuine must portray the aspect in the workplace, because Christianity or living a godly life is not really exhibited in the four corners of the church. I repeat, living a godly life is not really exhibited, or shouldn't be limited, maybe that's a better word to put it, in the four corners of the church. It should be rather in the workplace, what the Bible calls the marketplace. In the marketplace, we have to show kindness. In the marketplace, we have to show love. In the marketplace, because a lot of people will not read Bible. And trust me, when they read Bible, they will not even understand it. Because you and I, who are born again, how many times do we understand the Bible, especially when you come to genealogies? Some of the words you can't even pronounce. So they're not going to go there. But they look at your life, and they look at the life, and they say that this is becoming of Christ. The first Christians in Antioch were called Christians because of their generosity and how they helped the brethren in Jerusalem by giving. And so through that, they called them Christians, just to mean to say Christ-like. They look like Christ. And so Paul is saying here that we have a responsibility to make God's servant attractive. Doctrines have come into place where Christ is no longer attractive. And I'll go into a few of them. Maybe I'll give you five pointers and then we'll take it from there. So let me do it now. Number one, doctrine. Doctrine has made Christ very much unattractive. So for instance, you have certain people who come up with doctrines like women should not look good. So it's a sin to do lipstick. It's a sin to do your hair. Some even believe that when you plait your hair, it's a symbol of the spirit of serpent or snake. And trust me, somebody gave me a book to forward, and I read it, and I'm like, no, I cannot put my name to this book. Terrible things like that, you know. So doctrine. So at the end of the day, who wants to be a part of something that is sort of drawn or stuck to the stone ages? So Christianity is not attractive. Doctrine. And then doctrine gives birth to different perceptions. So for instance, the woman is a substandard person as compared to the man. And therefore, women can't do this, women can't do that. In fact, some people even hold doctrines that women can't teach, women can't preach, women can't lead, women can't. And so at the end of the day, when you have other women who look at these doctrines and they look at it and say, look, Christianity is not for me. I'd rather do something else. It makes it the same way. Then you come to the third point of behavior and character. And that is where people begin to exhibit. And the fact, the interesting thing is that they make everybody around them know that they are believers. So it is established. Then their behavior comes into play. They curse. They are very unkind. You know, you're going to have make yourself some tea. Will not even ask your fellow worker who sits opposite to you to do some of the tea for the person. You know, so you go and get your tea. You bring it on your table. You have your shortbread. Is it shortbread or long bread? Shortbread on your table, and you don't share your shortbread with anybody. You know, I went to boarding school, and the boarding school we used to take a particular grain they call gari, and it's very interesting. The Christian fellowship there was called the SU, and SU people will only give their brothers gari. So if you come and ask, oh, can I have some gari, they tell you, I don't have any gari. Just pull back, and then another brother comes and asks for gari, and then straight away, a lot of gari comes from the chop box. You know, and all these things don't make Christianity attractive. You know, and it's a ploy of the enemy. It really, really is a ploy of the enemy, not to make Christianity attractive so people can go to hell. But unfortunately also, some people have made Christianity over-attractive. You know, and that is the human nature for you. We are not able to keep a good balance. So some people have made it over attractive, and that has invited a whole bunch of worldliness and evil into the church. That is also bad. We need to get the balance right. So we have a situation where doctrine comes in. We have a situation where people's lifestyles come in. And then we have a situation where the structures we build in terms of services also becomes a problem, you know. So for instance, I know this particular place, they say that it is sinful to play the organ, it is sinful to play drums, it is sinful, you just have to sing hymns. And even the hymns, you must sing Old Ragged Cross. I mean, hymns from the Stone Age. And that is that. Now, anybody that walks into a place like that will not feel very, very comfortable and will not participate or engage. And then they say that, well, Christianity is not for me. And the last thing there are many reasons, but the last reason I want to give you, the faith I want to give you, is some of the things that we also entrust on people, because now we become very judgmental, extremely judgmental. So you go to somebody's home and a person has got a glass of wine or cognac or whatever, or the person smokes or something. Straight away, you jump at the person and you don't realize that these things are not sin. Sin is a detachment from Christ. And then when that person has realigned, the life in Christ then will help the person deal with all these other things that we call sin. And so it doesn't make it attractive. Can you imagine somebody just walks to you and the first doesn't show you love, the first thing it tells you, attack your personal life. You just have to say, look, I am not interested in this Christianity thing. And sometimes, that is why a lot of times actually, when we go on evangelism and things like that, we are not looking to present Christ. We are looking to tell people how sinful they are. And you don't need to remind them that they are sinful. You just look at your own life as a believer, how long you've been a believer and how many things you've been struggling with in your own life. And that tells you that you need to give somebody some room for the person to become born again. So he said that let that teaching about God as Savior be what? Attractive. Hallelujah. But not by the definition of our own definition. Okay? Because these days also a whole bunch of stuff have crept into the church that I personally have a problem with. But then again, like you go to certain churches. Well, no, put any church because everybody has their revelation. So let's move on. But sometimes the distraction is too much. Nobody worshiping anymore in certain places. People have to worship for you. So you have dancers that come up doing praise and worship, and then they have to do all the dances with their flags and everything else and stuff. I don't have a problem with that, but we can have a time in the service where those performers can perform and we enjoy the performance. But don't tell me that when everybody needs to connect with God, somebody is going... No. Forgive me, but I have an issue. I have issues with that. And don't misunderstand, if you are watching, we do have dance ministry, this ministry as well. But they perform when they have to perform. But when we have praise and worship time, I think it should be praise and worship, where everybody gets involved, everybody bring their praise. Nobody should be dancing for you. You should be doing your dancing. Nobody should be worshiping for you. You should be doing your worshiping. And then when we have all done and we have been satisfied that God has accepted, we sit down. Now we can call the dance ministry to come and give us and stuff like that. Sometimes, you know, we want to make so many things very attractive and then we overdo it. So we go to church and we don't feel very satisfied because church must involve worship. It must involve dancing. It must involve the praise. Because the reason why church was moved to Sunday and not Saturday is one, celebration. So every Sunday service must be a celebration by definition. Actually, we should have had set service on Saturday, which is the Sabbath. However, the reason why the church fathers moved it to Sunday is that Sunday was the resurrection. So the resurrection, so technically, when we all meet on Sundays, we are here to do what? Celebrate. So there must be a celebration. I will tell the choirs in this church, in our church, that if you're leading worship, whatever you do, there must be a time within the 30 or 45 minutes allotted to you that you let the church celebrate Christ. Because we are always bringing ourselves into remembrance of his resurrection. And so we have to celebrate him. We have to dance. We have to show our appreciation of what he has done for us. It's all part of the attractiveness. And we must make church very attractive. Hallelujah. In those days, what they define as attractiveness is different from our day. And that is why we have ushers. People, somebody who will help you in the car park. Somebody who will help you in the foyer. All these things make church attractive. But most importantly, according to this test, the word that goes out in teaching must be attractive. Some of you bank where you bank because it is very attractive. Some of you shop where you shop because it's very attractive. I know some of you, it's because it's cheap, but then again, if it is attractive and cheap, it's even better. Hallelujah. Amen. Then it goes on, for the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation toward all people. I love that. That's an offer salvation to, that's what I say to you. That offers salvation toward all people. Do you know what it means by that? It means that there are certain people who wouldn't go to certain churches. There are certain people who will not be able to understand the level of English in, say, an Anglican high church. But they are also candidates for salvation. You understand? So because church or the Christian life that has just been born is meant for all people, we must find different ways of reaching them. Now, Paul, who was writing this letter, is alluding to a particular fact. And that is, he has been called by God to pioneer a whole new movement called the Gentile to Christ movement. He is now talking into the Roman mind and the Greek mind that Jesus also died for you. And therefore, they must do that transition. For us, the Jewish believers always thought that because they waited for the Messiah and so on and so forth, this is our lot. But God says that I came to my own receives me not, but as many, I gave them power to become what? And our spirit cries forth, Abba, Father. Meaning that there has been now an engrafting. We have been grafted into the main source. So we are part of it. So church must be broad. That is why if you sit in a blue carpet, nice aeroplane chairs in, you should not use that as a standard to judge somebody who is in a ghetto. Because those in the ghetto also need Christ. And you cannot take your suit and your holy self with all your money trimmings and suffrages to that ghetto to go and evangelize. Are you hearing me? But they also need Christ. So there will be a way God will tailor their salvation to them. Then the person who doesn't speak English and speaks some other language, you need to be able to find someone who can be able to communicate to them. Somebody who doesn't even speak proper English, maybe pidgin English, you have to be able to learn how to speak the pidgin English. Because everybody, salvation has been opened up to all peoples. May I submit to you, some of you may have to work with prostitutes. Hallelujah. But make sure you are truly called to them. One of our friends told us, her friend went to Holland and he was really moved by what he saw at the red light district. And he said, no, I have to save these people. So he started a ministry at the red light district and it went for a few months and then he was saved. He went to saved. Eventually, he became saved. That's a coded language. I'll leave it there. So you got to be in the field of academia. We need people in the field. There are certain professors, they will not listen to you. What qualification do you have? But if there's some, I like what Professor Robert Winston wrote. I was reading some of his articles challenging the Darwinian theory, stuff like that. You know, the man who brought the IVF, who pioneered IVF and stuff. I don't know if he's a believer. I'm told he's a believer. But anyway, what he wrote, Defending Faith, was very wonderful because he has a caliber. He is a scientist. He has read, he has invented, in fact, he has pioneered IVF. I mean, he's very much respected. He's a cell or something. He's very much respected in the community. Now, not all his colleagues are going to listen to him, but at least he can argue with them on that basis. So there are times that we need people in that bracket. Are you hearing me? There are times that we need people in the gutter too. Because there are certain people, they will not go into the gutter. So if somebody is not subscribing to your church, don't be angry because maybe it's too fine for them. Somebody else also will go to a place where everybody speaks proper English without a trimming. I want some tea. You know, and don't criticize that. Sometimes people like to go to the high church. It doesn't mean that they are not born again because they like the high church stuff. You know, the priest comes with a big staff, you know, with a verger and all the choir boys following with the candle, and then the incense blowing your nose to bits and stuff. You find God in there. You find God, trust me, you find God in there. You see, so long as they don't say Jesus be cursed, so long as they are exalting the name of Jesus, their liturgy and all those things is up to them. So long as they're not telling people that it is okay to kill one another, they're telling people that Jesus never existed, and they are killing the main aspect of the gospel. That is what? Because salvation has come to how many people? All people. Again, the poor, the needy. And you know, sometimes, let me tell you a quick story that happened in Kenya. I'm not going to mention the person's name. But this woman of God, very powerful woman of God in America, was going to Kenya to do a conference. And that particular area where he was going to speak, their view there is prostitutes that wear trousers. So they don't wear trousers. Then she, with her American self, said that they must be enlightened. So nobody's going to tell her how to dress. She spent so much money, flew her team, everything from America to this particular province in Kenya. When they went the first day, I mean, the women, you know, when Africans, we have, I don't know why it is like that, but when we hear big names from the other side of the world are coming, it's a different story altogether. Sometimes we don't like our own, we like other this, but that's okay, that's another story. And the place was packed out. The woman turns up at the podium in trousers. A few people walked out. The following day, the conference was empty. And then his people told her, "We told you. You don't disrespect people's views. You come alongside them to help them change their view if it is wrong. So what could have been better is come in the skirt and then teach. And then let them understand that it is not what you wear. And then give them all the understanding, because you cannot start people from where they are not. You start people from where they are. And so salvation is for all people. There are those who will not even appreciate you because of what you stand for. You cannot go cursing them. Christ also needs the people. A friend of mine introduced me to somebody who traveled somewhere, and the person I'm sure has heard of my name so much, so he was mentioning to me, "So, oh, you meet Dr. Pastor Shadrach." I said, no, that cannot be Pastor Shadrach. I said, I am Pastor. No. The Pastor Shadrach, I know, will not wear jeans. Because genuinely, her views is that a pastor should not wear jeans. And it's a sin for a pastor to actually wear jeans. And thank God she was open and honest. She did not miss her words. He said, "If you are, then I'm sorry. You are doing something wrong. You shouldn't be in jeans." I took it nice, because I believe I'm a nice person. You know, but salvation have come to how many people? All people. We have different sets of people. You know, that's what Jesus said, that when you come to heaven, there's a sea of different types of people from different tongue, different tribe, and so on and so forth. That's why I tell you, if you are white, don't go and tan yourself. Be who you are. If you are black, don't go and bleach. No Abidjan Clayton. Hallelujah. Because in heaven, we're going to be, God loves the way we are. And for those of you who are thinking that when the rapture happens, your color will change, it will not change. It will be the same color. So get used to your color. Hallelujah. Because it pleases God to have different people from different nationalities, different tongues, and different tribes. Because that is what he's been asserted here. It appeared to every people. Then 12 goes on to say, it teaches us to say no. And in my scripture, the no has been placed in an emphatic mood. No to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to self, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. So let's develop that. So then he goes on to say that this salvation now has appeared to all people. But no matter who you are, whether you are in a poor state, whether you are in Kenya or you are in Africa or you are, Kenya or you are in America or whatever, whether you are white or black or green or yellow, whether you are a woman or man, whether you are what have you, one thing that must underline every believer, lethargy is one thing. You go to certain churches, the preaching is 20 minutes. And woe betides you if you go 21 minutes. Yet announcement is about 1 hour. That is their lethargy. That is okay. So our lethargies might differ. Some churches, you have to do praise songs and then do worship. Some churches you do worship songs and then you do praise songs. Some churches you don't do any. You go straight to the word. And then after church, the pastor will just tell you, let's sing two more songs. Some you do hymn, praise, fast, slow, top, hot songs. All these things are fine, but they tell it to whichever denomination you work in, and God is not angry with that. But one thing must underline every believer's life, whether you worship in the ghetto or you worship in a fine environment, whether you're black or you're white, whether you're male or female, say no to ungodliness and worldly passions. This cuts across every person who calls on the name of God. And live self-controlled life, upright and godly lives. And he didn't say tomorrow. He said in this present age. It's unfortunate that we are experiencing in the body these things almost on a daily basis. I was making a joke, but I was deadly serious about that. That in this present age, even among believers, somebody's wife is somebody's girlfriend. Somebody's girlfriend is somebody's husband. Somebody's husband is somebody. I mean, it is just despicable. And most of these guys or these people call on the name of the Lord. I think there must be a voice to kill these things in the root and have godly lives prevail in us. God didn't say that he would take our passions all away. Because if he takes passion away, how are we going to love our wives and husbands? But what he says is that you can control those passions by the power of the Holy Spirit. So if you're saying that God is not giving you that power, then it means that you don't have the Holy Spirit. Then there's a tendency that you're not born again in the first place. So it's important that we open ourselves up to God to help us make Christian life attractive. Again, we are not perfect, but that is why we have God. So we can always go to him with our imperfections, and he will help us through. And he will help us through because he wants this thing called Christianity to be very attractive. I'll go with the 13 and I'll take some questions. He said, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. So that the whole concept is that we should become purified, but the purification that Paul is putting across here is one thing. He says they're eager to do good. And I realize that anytime you are eager to do good, somewhere, somehow, God gives you the strength, the might, and ability to be able to do it. Why? Because God wants a situation where he doesn't have to have another satanic encounter after rapture. So he is training all of us and telling us that selfishness, which is Satan's number one character, not be part of us. Wickedness, which depicts Satan, not be part of us. And things that stop us from loving God and all that kind of stuff, we don't pass them on to other people. Because we are, as always say, we are a race. We are not a company. The angels are a company. So anytime they make mistakes, they are booted out of heaven. And their mistakes don't affect one another. But we are a race. So nobody can sit down and say, I don't care. I told you about Achan. When Achan did what he did, it's not only Achan that died. So many people died, and then his own family also died. His cats and dogs, who that haven't even offended, they all died. Because that is what happens. When one person makes a mistake, it kills other people. You have a situation where a bus goes into a ditch and kills people, and you go and brutalize the driver, is drunk. Why didn't the accident say that it is the driver's fault? So it's only the driver that is going to die. No, it kills innocent people too, because we are a race. When you make a mistake, you affect other people. And so it's very important that before we make any move, we evaluate our move. We see what is it going to do to family? What is it going to do to church? It looks like some believers just don't have conscience. Just don't have conscience. And I'm not taking the moral high ground. I'm not perfect myself. But at the end of the day, he says that you strive for what is good. And trust me, when you're striving for what is good, God will show you loopholes and stuff that you can be able to. And the things that you have difficulty in handling, he gives you energy. He gives you strength. He gives you mind. Paul has such a situation, and he went to the Lord. And the Lord said to Paul, he said, my strength is made perfect in your weakness. I've given you the grace to do that. I didn't see Paul pray that prayer again, because he now keyed into that grace God gave him, and he became a better person. Look at what he says. He says, when I was a child, I thought as a child, I behaved as a child, I do stuff as a child, but now that I am an adult, I put away childish things. May I tell you that sometimes it feels like a lot of us, we were children, we did what children did, and now we are adults, we are still children. And it's sad that in the body, we dress nice and everything, but in the spirit, it's like we're wearing diapers and sucking our thumb with a 40-year-old, 50-year-old, 60-year-old, because we have become so petty, and we are not striving for that which is good. Paul's argument is very clear. He says, Titus, you need to set the structures in the churches in Crete and put leaders, or should I say bishops, who are episcopal, elders, who then will make sure they will then instruct other people so the church is an attractive place. When the church becomes an attractive place, there are those who, if it wasn't, they wouldn't come in. But because of that, they will what? Respond. It's very interesting also to realize that when God has given you that grace and that authority to do stuff, he also gives you an angelic guidance and strength in order for that purpose, because he goes on to say, these then are the things you should teach. Encourage and rebuke with all authority. Do not let anyone despise you. What does it mean, do not let anyone despise you? Next week, Wednesday, we will look at that and then take it into chapter 3 and see how you work your things out. Because somebody once mentioned something very powerful. It calls it the tyranny of sin. The tyranny of sin. So what happens is that when there's an issue for you to address or deal with, they begin to give you reasons why you can't do that. And so now we are more concerned about petty things than concerned about weightier matters. And Paul is saying that, don't let anybody despise you. Don't let them say that you're not qualified to correct. You're qualified. Because if your brother sins, rebuke him. Talk to him. This is wrong. This is the way things ought to be done. And so and so forth. If he doesn't, leave the person to God. But remember, because we are raised, if we don't deal with things the way they ought to, eventually it will affect you. And that is what Paul was arguing about.